Hello guys, welcome back, and if you are new here, my name is Noemi, and for today I have a very exciting video for you. You guys had a lot of questions about homeschooling, so for today I gathered 20 ideas that is helping us on a harder days. We have good days that are amazing and productive and all the kids are working and on the roll, and then we have days when it is really a struggle. Okay, so the first one is my mood. My kids are super sensitive to the vibes that is flowing in the house. So if I wake up with a messy mind and in a bad mood, then it will set them for the same thing. So if I try to work on myself in the morning, so that meaning I have a self-care routine in the morning, I am more ready for them. The second one for us, it made a major change, and that is music. And the music is something that doesn't have any singing in there, it's just a very bland music. So we have a list that they can pick from, and each kid likes different, so sometimes we rotate who can choose that music. It's something with that their attention goes into focusing on what they're doing. It helps them to focus on things that are more important than to bugging each other. I will have a few of them down below in the description box. I will link it down below for you guys, so you guys can maybe use the same. Music and a math is being progressed on the same side of the brain. So I think that's why maybe it's helping them to focus, but it is definitely an easier way when we have music in the background. Okay, the third one is one of my favorite that is really, really something different from the school system. And that is taking the focus on what they know. So when I'm going through on their work, and you know, you have those red markers when you have the check mark, okay, this is good, and then you make a big sign around that, that this is bad. So when I was a kid, I remember when we were getting back our test and I saw the red ones, and the more red I saw, the more I stressed out I was. So instead of using a red marker, I eliminated the red one and I started to use a green one that is a less harsh color, and I circled the ones that are good. And if we take a lesson, obviously there's gonna be more that they know, so that's gonna be a more encouragement for them to focus on, oh look, here's 100, you got 60 or 70, good, so let's see the other 30%. And I don't circle them, because to me, it's my point is not to point out what they made mistake, it's like, hey, you can retry that. So I just simply erase that, and we are not moving on to the next topic until they can figure out that one. So that means they are working towards something. So it's not like accomplishing the test itself, but more like getting and gaining the acknowledge how to do that skill, that specific skill. Okay, the next point is to break it down. I got to kids that are cannot be more different from each other if we talk about learning. One loves to see the pile what he needs to learn that day, so that comforts him. Okay, this is the amount I need to get through, and I want to see it all. The other one, if I would put that package front of him, he would just curl up in a ball in the corner and rock himself to a happy place. It's just not the way he processes things. So with him, I have a full paper of work. I just cut out little slice, so it's not even a whole entire page, just little slice. And once he's done with one slice, then I give him the next one. And once he's done with that, he's asking me, okay, what's next? So it's kind of like once he's done, he's able to move on and do the next. Eventually, I'm pretty sure he will mature into when he can handle more. Like, we are at the point he can handle a whole entire page. But back then, I remember that was the key for us to start, for him to learn. So it was always a struggle to get him on board. But once I figured that I just need to cut it up to slices to break it down for him, it's kind of like a big project for us as an adult. Like if I'm about to edit a big video that is about 200 footage, I have a stage that I call, I just want to push my eyes out and run away. But if I focus on just five footage and I edit that and I get a little break, I walk around and I come back, it's completely doable. So it same applies to the kid. Okay, the next one is figuring out the learning process for your kids. And that means there are three categories. One is a visual, it's given. They learn easier as they see things. And the second one is the auditory, and the third one is a kinetic. So mainly in the school system, when you sit at the desk and you're listening to the teacher, that is supports mainly the auditory person. And my kids, one is on the kinetic side, the other one is a visual. I find that with my kinetic one, I got this huge white board for him, and every time he had to do a math, he didn't enjoy as much to do this on the paper. But once he was standing and he was doing big moves with his hands, which by the way is the key ingredient to learn a fine motor skills, that's the basic. You start with big circles, so it's all starting from a big movement. So for him, standing at the whiteboard or jumping while I was reading out loud when we were learning the word device, oh, that's the best book, guys. It's amazing. I will link it down below for you guys. But basically, that book is explains like what the word, what the meaning of the word, how to spell it, how to use it, how to comprehend it in sentence. So it's been amazing. So while I was reading out loud for him and he just put it on the whiteboard, he was jumping. So that helped him so much. Now, these days, he's able to sit down and learn more that way. But when my kids were little, it was actually a key to get them on the board to learn. Okay, the next one is to minimize distraction. And I mean, it really depends on the person. But my older one was definitely, and my younger one too, but my older one is definitely impacted by how he's surrounded with when he's learning. So that means it has to be something somewhat organized and less stimulative place that he likes to learn. And he definitely learn faster when I have less stimulation around him. And that means I don't have those crazy posters. I started out with those. I get so excited from homeschooling. I get all the big bright and purple and red big pictures and everything. But seriously, his eyes, you should just have seen, it was going all over the place. So, and then I discovered that just a simple desk, a very calm environment, not too many things around him, was helping him tremendously to focus on things. And same applies to me. I like to create. I feel like I can be more creative if I have less things around me. And that's why you see my kitchen is very simple, because I can focus on the food. I can concentrate on creating recipes. So some kids can benefit from how is the setup while he learns. I think that was what started our minimalist journey. Or I mean, we started to declutter before that, but that was an ultimate stamp when I put everything into a big gear and I saw some result. Okay, the next point is absolutely something that is, I would say, is more like for the long-term help, but I can see the benefits, so that's why I wanna share it with you. And that is, I had to teach my kids how to learn. So when they get this courage, and that was an ultimate done for the school day, when they started to feel upset about like if they didn't understand something for the first time. And of course you can explain, oh, you don't have to understand for the first time, but just creating that habit, I explained to them, if you don't understand that, just keep reading it again and again and again, and there's no shame in there. This is the way where you can process things. When they were asking me questions because they got stuck with some kind of, either they didn't understand that word or they find something they couldn't understand, I didn't explain to them right away. I ask them, what kind of source would you use to figure that out? How about if we Google it? How about if you use YouTube? Like, use the computer as a source. So we don't have games, but they do like to use softwares like creating website and other things. So what I like to teach to them is that technology is something that is a tool that is helping you. What do you think? Where could you get that information from? But that is researching, so they learning to learn how they can figure things out, and that will be beneficial in the long term because I cannot be always there for them. That is something, it has to come from inside, and this is what I want to support in them, to be hungry for information, to enjoy that, and you want to learn. The next point is taking things outside, and that means sometimes we just so burned out with the same situation, so we don't really learn exactly on the same place as every single day. Sometimes we choose that table, sometimes at the kitchen, sometimes they want to do it on the couch, and sometimes if the weather permitting, it can be outside on the picnic table or on the patio or under the big tree on the picnic blanket. So we don't even actually have to leave from home. Just grab a blanket and just use our backyard. But even just being exposed to the outside, the light is very important for the kids. It definitely makes you more alert and the fresh air. And just changing the surrounding, it helps so much. The next point can be something similar, and that meaning is just go for a walk. If you see the kids are burned out and they just don't get it, that is the breaking point. They are done. So we just go for a walk. We just go outside and have some fresh air and distract ourselves from that situation. And guess what? When we come back and sit down with a fresh head, they can get it in 1 second. So it's really not worth it to over push when they burned out. But just even if you go for a little walk can help so much. The next one is rotation. And that means I'm talking about the method, how I teach them. So 1 week we do Khan Academy. However, as much as I love Khan Academy, it's done on the computer and I can see they are getting tired of that. I think it's a more of a dry way to teach the kids. But sometimes if I get busy, I use Khan Academy. And then the next week we have some books and workbooks, or we switch to YouTube. Like, we do so many history things on YouTube. I love Crash Course. It's an amazing channel. I will leave it down below for you guys. So just switching between the computer, the workbook, and the YouTube, and just me teaching them is something that I find refreshing for them. The next one is very similar to my tip that I do. So I read an article about people, I think it was in a Japanese island, so it has a specific name for it, where people live really, really long. And what they find is a key ingredient in their life for these people is that they have goal every single day. And that's how kind of I thrive too. I find myself too easier to get up in the morning if I have set a goal like, hey, I want to organize that closet, or I want to create 2 recipes, or just some kind of goal that I have that I want to do that day. So I do the same thing with my kids. Before they go to the bed, I always ask them, what kind of skill do you want to learn tomorrow? You know, something that is one topic so they can focus more on that. And in the morning, I ask them again, what is your goal for today? And of course, again, this can contain different things, like my goal is to bike a half an hour, or go to jiu-jitsu class, or something else, and learn the fractions. So it's included in their day, and it's more like they are going towards to something that is a goal. The next one, I'm just saying next one because I have no idea where I am at this point. Good nutrition and good sleep. But I just wanna emphasize to you how important is that. Just think about it, like, if I, coming from that, from my perspective, when I'm tired, I'm hungry, and I'm driving home, and I just only think, okay, I just need to hang in there for 2 minutes, and I will get home, and I can eat. I know that. but my body is struggling. So with the car, you cannot do this. When the gas is out, it's out. It's not gonna go and push itself, you know, to further destination. So I had to rearrange thoughts in my head. How important is to eat and eat the things that is actually helping us to function. And that has a wide variety. Even as a four of us, we eat four different kind of way that suits us and makes us function very well. But in the morning, I definitely like to avoid processed food, and cereal is a processed food. It's a highly processed food with barely any nutrition in there. Yes, it got fiber, but fiber itself is not really nourishing you. It just helps you to swipe out all the toxins from your body, but it has nothing to do with a good brain fatty foods like avocado or something that is raw. I think processed food is not helping kids' brain at all. If they like it, that's fine, but make sure to combine something else in their foods that supports the brain. So I really, really like to focus in the morning on what they eat and how they eat it, because that's important too, to without stress, without rushing, just really just calmly eat that, and that will really build into the brain. Okay, the next one is for the days when you can already tell, no matter how much you try, that kid doesn't wanna learn, because there are days like that. Absolutely. So I like to warm them up from playing aspect. As my kids are getting older, of course, it's been changing, but I would say it still applies on a really hard days when they don't want to learn. But my older one is old enough that he knows he needs to work, he needs to learn. That's no escape. But for younger kids, you know, once you get them into the place when they are very grumpy, there's no way things gonna go into their brain. There's no way. I like to start with this on the days like that. I'm just showing you one game, but this is one of them, and I'm pretty sure if you've been watching my channel for a while, you have seen it. And basically it's just a very nice game that teaches you math. So it shows the fractions. So it just shows the fractions, and there are some cards that you have to pull, and it's got different ones. You have to fill it up as you pull the card, like it has to be a whole. If you went over, you know you lost that. So it's just a very quick way to show you. I'm pretty sure you couldn't get a whole entire picture from this very short explanation, but I got a couple of games and I will link it down below for you. Actually, I don't have to link it. It's in my Amazon store. I have a whole entire section that where I collected all the games that we have. And so I'm just starting out with a game. And also this is something we can do in the afternoon when they are tired, but we couldn't get done as much as I wanted to. Something with the play fact. They start to smile, they start to play, and then they are more open to learn. Okay, let me do this on paper now. Let's see how much you can do on the paper. You know what I'm saying? It's just start something. Just start something that is engages him, and then you can just redirect his interest then. Okay, the next point, I want to explain to you why is it important to have the kids into a creative stage when you are teaching them or when they are learning. So when this is the brain, and when you in a rational mind, this is how it looks like. So this is basically when you sit down at the table and you're trying to learn. And it's really hard to get in there, right? So when your brain start to be on the creative side, your brain starts to move and open. And when it's open, it becomes like a sponge. Information can go easier into your brain. So that's why I like to start with creative things that is engaging for the kids, because that way they are more absorbing the information. And just think about it, like how I learned the editing. I never I mean, I'm not even close to handle a phone, let alone an editing program or software. I still don't know anything about technology, but because I was interested in it, I was excited to learn. I learned that really fast. I picked it up very fast because when I started to do the editing, I got into the creative mood. I just really realized how much I can do with that. And it made me hungry for information even more. So the same with the kids, if they can do creative things, and that means hands-on projects. So if you teach them history and you do a little hands-on projects with that, they will definitely remember these things better. Even when my kids playing with the Lego and they being creative, in the background, we have some history on YouTube playlist. I always thought, nah, they're not hearing that much things from that. I mean, they're playing with Lego. And you know what, guys? The other day, I was coming out from the room and I heard them. They were eating breakfast and they were just not arguing, but kind of like debating like how the Second World War was started. I was like, okay, at least they are talking about it. That means they are interested in it and they have their viewpoint and they can talk about it. So that means they know something about it. So it definitely, kids are little sponges. Just think about when you as moms trying to talk in the kitchen, and as soon as you have a topic that you don't want the kids to hear and you go quiet, you know, they go quiet, they listen, they hear you. So this is the same as a thing. If when kids are doing something, they listen. So just have something, history or whatever, just even an audio book or something in the background while they play with the Lego, it just helps so much. Okay, the next one is having books in the car. If you want to have your kids read a lot, the best place to force them to read is in the car. Like if there's no phone and there's no other entertainment, you're driving for hours and there are books, believe me, eventually they will reach for it. So at the beginning, when they were little, I put all those little itty bitty books that you can buy from the dollar store, you know, those thin ones that is just really, you can go very quickly. I had so many of them between them in a box and I was constantly rotating those. And let me tell you, we had a really good car ride. Besides audiobooks, we usually listened audiobooks too in the car. But reading books is golden. It's still today. When we went to the library, those days were the quietest rides ever. I knew I was able to do a bunch of things on that day. They wouldn't complain because they had the books. Okay, the other thing that helped us, and again, it really depends on the kid. One of my kids is definitely more relies on it than the other, and that is schedule. And I'm not talking about like 9 o'clock, we drop everything and we start to learn. But we aiming for that time, you know, 9 o'clock, we need to sit down. So that means hurry up with brushing the teeth and eating the breakfast. So we have some kind of time that we aiming for. And one of my kid is definitely thriving on that and craving that. If we slip out of that schedule, then he requires that he wants the schedule, or he just independently, he starts to learn on his own because he just wants to get it done and move on. The other one needs a little bit more encouragement to do that, but definitely I see less of an argument from both sides. You know, at the beginning of September, after the long summer break, when you have a hard time to get back, you can see how much the schedule is actually helping, because after a week or so, they know this is what's coming, this is what you're going to do. So a schedule, a somewhat schedule, if you don't do even a strict schedule, but somewhat like we need to learn in the morning. I like to pick the morning, but sometimes we do outing in the early morning and learn afterwards, but the majority of the time we start to just get it out of the way and we have a somewhat structure in that. Okay, the next one is kind of silly, but I want to share it because it was motivational for my boys. But drawing on the papers that we are learning, that helps so much. So my water gun is very visual, so if I start to draw some kind of silly or funny things to explain, that definitely grabbed his attention. But also what really motivated them, I told them, once you're done with the whole thing, you can draw on it whatever you want. And I remember my younger one was like, light up his little eyes, and he was like, can I draw a car on it? Yeah, sure, whatever you want. So it was definitely motivating for him that he can do something on the paper that he wants, that he's not forced, but what he wants. So that was his, instead of the sticker, you know, that usually just given out after you've done something good, I just let them draw on the paper whatever they want. A silly thing, something really silly. The other one I like to give my kids is supplement, and that is cod liver oil. You can research it, make sure you find something that is really good for them. But I find the kind that I really trust. It doesn't have heavy metals in there, it's tested and it's a good stuff. So I like to give them that type of cod liver oil, which I know you guys are going to ask, so I will put it down below in the link in the description box for you. But that is something I can definitely see if with a good breakfast and with a good sleep, after I give them that supplement, they are actually set to a good day for learning. And more importantly, you guys, just enjoy your kids. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you guys soon. Bye! I cut, so once, how do I explain this? Oh my god, oh my god. Wow, that's a lot. I talk a lot. Bam. Okay. Ah. Dun-dun. And, I mean, you know.
No, you don't know.
That means you wanna learn about, gonna be forever to edit. No one will watch this. I mean, it takes forever. Oh my God. It's really applies to that one is applies to my